Thank you very much, guys, for your analysis. Steele, do you agree? Do you think that Dignitas are ready to just stroll on in and take this game?
Absolutely. This is their map pick as well. Even though that Epsilon gets the counter-terror side on this, Dignitas has the momentum. If they're able to string together, I'd say even five rounds on their Terra side of this map, they're going to look healthy going into the semifinals.
Now, Shox, we were talking in the break. That round that we picked up on where GMX hit the double, where FXCO went aggressive, those types of aggressive gambles, I guess you could call it. Dignitas don't gamble ever.
No.
They win as a team, they lose as a team.
Yeah, and that's something that Dignitas does really well together. They play together as a team. They play the crossfires. They don't give away any aggressive, you know, they don't put themselves in a situation where they can lose a player or be a man down or be at a disadvantage. And that's what makes them so strong together as a unit.
So what do they have to do to go on and win a major LAN? What is it that's missing? Because we can sit here and wax lyrical about how good they are, but they're lacking the trophy cabinet.
So when they're playing really smart, really safe, really passive, and they're playing these really good setups, it doesn't give them any room to kind of get an advantage, either that being map control, that being a man up. The same reason why it's so good for them is the reason why it's bad for them. So if they're playing the same style and they're getting, you know, crushed by a team, let's say they were to play against Virtus Pro or NiP, and they were playing NiP and Virtus Pro, where they're playing a style, they were able to pick off a player and then do a really good psych take, and Dignitas, their retakes aren't working so well, they need to do something where they're able to go and get an early pick. And we sometimes see it from Fetish going a little bit aggressive with his op, trying to get an early pick and kind of change the tides of the battle. But maybe it's that when they get down to those high-pressure matches deeper into the tournament, they need to start making these kind of risky plays. It is a risk, but sometimes it's a needed risk.
Now, moving on to Epsilon.
Sure. You.
How do we talk about something other than shocks? Because it's true, but it's also easy to say Epsilon need shocks to perform for Epsilon to win. Mm-hmm. But how do we talk about something wider for Epsilon?
It's difficult to talk wider about them. They used to be good with their old roster, but then like there's been roster changes, players going to Titan, players going going to LDLC, just like moving around the French scene, and I think. Of all the teams, you know, Titan's strong, LDLC is strong, Epsilon's strong, but, like, who's the strongest of the three? And I think that of the three teams, Epsilon kind of got stuck with the not-as-skilled players. So when we talk about Epsilon, we talk about Shox because he is the player that was on Titan. He is often considered best player in the world, so everyone's going to talk about him. It's his team. He's leading it. He's, you know, if he's playing really well, they're winning. If he's playing poorly, they're losing. He is what makes the team tick. He is the glue.
Well, let's see whether the glue can hold them all together as we move on to map two. It is Inferno that Epsilon must win. It's Dignitas' map pick, and it will be overpass that awaits both sides, should that be the case. Your money, Josh, where are you putting it?
Dig.
And for the tournament?
Ooh.
VP was looking really strong. I don't know. I don't know if current Dig could take down a VP that I saw yesterday.
You don't want to back your North American brothers? You don't believe in freedom?
Freedom isn't free.
I don't know. Honestly, it's too tough to say. VP's looking like they're on fire right now, though. Epsilon's looking kind of shaky. You can see right there as well, actually. He's not looking as calm and collected as he did after that 4K on the eco.
So we're ready to get this map underway. It is the ESL 1 Cologne $250,000 CSGO Championship. This is back where it belongs, the home of CS major events here in Germany. We're ready to go. It's been long absent from the big screens here, but let's right those wrongs right here with a great map. And every time I come to the crescendo of the end of that speech, waiting for us to just go into the round.
We're looking at players' faces.
We're looking at players' faces. So, as we get ready to get back into this one, thinking wider about this Dignitas side, the way that Fetish has them set up, you heard that Richard talking about him reading the Riot Act. to his players. Does that work, having, you know, such a central leader, master, and commander?
I'd say it does. Like, especially when you get together in a group huddle before the game, you kind of like talk about, okay, this is the map we're going to go into. This is what the other team does. These are the tiles. These are, you know, their habits. These are their tendencies. Look out for them. If you see it, we can, you know, capitalize on it. So he's not only just getting the team rallied together, giving them motivation, giving them like a little speech. He's actually talking about what's going on in this next game, what they need to do to win, and what they need to not do to win.
Is there a master and commander in iBuy power?
Working on it.
Here we go. Shox is ready to lead the defense. The nade goes, does well and does a lot of damage, and he follows it up with a frag onto Fetish. Now can GMX help himself to a frag as well? No, but has maintained his position and somehow managed to get a good 5 seconds shooting down and towards that site. Now has definitely been focused on once again, as the nade comes in, does damage again to both the Dupree and Device, who are on a two-thirds health, each of them. Epsilon come charging in, lose two men. The three guns are more powerful for Dignitas as they clean out. GMX has just the one onto Zipnix and has only two bullets. It's enough for, well, I was going to say one for each head, but he will go one on two again. He's got less than 100 health that he's got to shoot down, but there's the first. And is that the second? You bet it is. GMX pulls Epsilon back. But with the clock ticking, can he pull this one off? No! Oh, GMX, part of you feels like you deserve it because he got the two frags, but
he didn't know where the bomb was. That's
what it was. Jumped up on the box.
It was that millisecond he jumped up on the box, got the entire field of vision. Where's the bomb? There it is. Let's go for it. That millisecond to locate the bomb is what lost him the round.
Wow. Just when Epsilon maybe needed a little rub of the green, they didn't get it. But the surrendering of that site as well.
I wouldn't say it was a surrender as much as it was like they just got overrun. Like, Dignitas just pushed in there. They had the offensive on their T side. They smoked off mid. They flashed up mid. They pushed all together. Some of the players had armor. Some of the players didn't, but they just pushed in all together, and so hard with a USP to actually get those kills in that situation. So we're just going to see Epsilon losing that pistol round, getting CZs on the second round, and that's kind of what they need to kind of pull this together. I mean, CZs on this map, we can see all five of the Epsilon players with one. So maybe they're trying to get lucky, close combat, in the apartments, down banana, but it looks like Dig is just playing it way too patiently. A minute left on the clock still. And AZ's just going to kill everyone through the smokes.
As he does. He has transitioned into the role of superstar CS player so smoothly, AZ, since joining Dignitas. And, well, FXO now is the last man standing. One on five. Gets the first, as Dupree will go down. But the second will be dispatched as well. But Epsilon, in the end, are not going to be able to clone that one out. And FXO was ready to make us all excited. Dignitas will race into a two-round advantage. For them, now as you look across a few kind words exchanged between the teams, for them as you look across onto Epsilon, they need a confidence boost out of somewhere, something that can get shocked, fired up.
Yeah, I mean, we're seeing another full CZ buy from the counter terrace here. One good round from Shox, one good round as a team even, where they just completely annihilate Dig on a push and someone gets like a five-man. That might give them a little bit of a spark, you know, just what they need to kind of ignite the rest of the game. But right now it looks like they're just peeking one by one, getting picked off by the Dignitas kind of defensive push. But it looks like Kiyoshima's able to pick up one, but they're not doing anything as a team right now. They're kind of just like peeking one by one.
The way Dignitas play, whether it's attack or defense, that second gun is only ever a second away. And that is almost impenetrable.
It also kind of be nice to see Epsilon doing like, we see them doing gamble pushes where they push like three players. What if they tried that as a stack? What if they tried, you know, instead of having the CZs and push there, what if they just played two CZs or three CZs even, one at the first orange box on the B-bomb site, one behind the tri-box and one behind the spools there, and kind of just wait for Dignitas to push into the bomb site, and they just, you know, Dignitas runs into the Epsilon stack. Instead, we saw one player peek off the steps, die, and then his teammate was just trapped in the site.
There it is, 3-0, as Epsilon have themselves work to do on their now first buy round. And when there are moments that win games, that build momentum, that 3-0 lead is built off a millisecond of one decision to jump on the box, a millisecond, however you want to manage it. And that is what wins tournaments. Maybe that will be the difference in this map. As, this time, Epsilon, sit back. No gamble this time. No information either for them. So it's Device who was looking for that same peek from SF that he was guilty of in the last round. GMX's name tosses down. He just wants to see a, just show him a face. Just show him some love, and he'll have done his job. Retreats regardless with what he heard.
I think he might try to re-peek into there with a flash from his teammate in just a moment. Scratch that. Epsilon's reading something something else at the moment.
Dignitas get ready to make their move. It's going to be Dupree who pushes in. And the smoke down towards the pit won't hold him off as he makes his way in now. Shox gets himself frag number one. GMX with the second. Epsilon looking to hold on. Now Shox sits deep, looking for those Dignitas players to come towards him as his teammates begin to fall. Zipnix can see the left-hand side of Shox. Can Shox do anything from this position? The answer is no, as Dupree avenges, and now it will be Device to move in, get himself the kill onto Kiyoshima, and Epsilon are down to a 2-3. With a bomb to be defused. And, see that flash down and towards the pit. They're desperate to dispatch of Zipnix, who has been the real anchor of this attack on that right-hand side. That he's hidden, well pushed away, and ready to show himself at the last moment to finish off the job. And Dignitas will go into a 4-round lead.
Actually, if Shox had actually thrown the flash into the apartments for GMX there to peek, they would have known that it was an A hit. They would have stayed. They would have had three players at the bomb site. But instead, what happened was Dignitas was so quiet at the top of middle, and Epsilon was so passive in the site, Epsilon actually read that as a B hit. So they started rotating the stack three players over the B bomb site, and that's the precise timing that Dignitas actually did their A hit against only two defending Epsilon members.
Dignitas who lead the assault. So was that a gamble from Epsilon to go B? Because they didn't have any information to base that decision off. They're just like, well, time's passed. B's probably the one that might be easiest for them.
Yeah, I think what they planned to do was just like, I don't know if they wanted to stack it or if they wanted to do a three-man push as soon as the third player got there. But I think they read, just straight up read that Dignitas was going to do an A fake and then end up hitting B, or maybe doing a B split, something along those lines. But they just completely misread the round.
GMX is the last one standing. And you thought he could have finished there, and second bite of the cherry will do so. He's going to have to deliver an ace to win this round, and he's got people hunting him out. And it will be Dupree to be the first man there, and already takes a huge chunk of health off him. As he pre-shoots, waiting for him to show himself, and then finishes off the job with a headshot as well to boot. 5-0 Dignitas! Epsilon are still reeling from their map one defeat.
And like I said at the start of this game, if Dig gets five rounds on their T side, they're not going to have a problem going into the CT side. They've got five in a row. They can still get another 10 if you're an optimist. If they get a 15-0, I mean, obviously they're going to win. But this is like, this is all they need on this side. Anything more, anything extra, it's just giving them so much cushion space. Ooh, that's a good nade. 56 damage points there.
Fexio holding him with his Zor. Got Device ready to push up, looking for SF and get himself the headshot through the smoke. Nice play. And he'll sit at the top of an Arno waiting for the next person to show. And that's the difference between the two setups. Dignitas would never leave that one man peeking and trying to, you know, find anything out there. The second gun on B was Kiyoshima, and he's all the way at the back.
Mm-hmm.
Now he's going to have to face that one alone, or will someone move over from the A site? Dupree gets himself the next, and what can you do against this?
Oh,
wow, GMX passes him as Zipnix just waltzes through. GMX will see action regardless. He sees that one, goes for the first hit. It's got help on the other side as well as GMX finishes off the job. And we're down to just 3-on-3 now as GMX will come back looking for Zipnix in the pit as that Molotov is perfectly timed. GMX was ready to come charging into the site and in the end was ushered away. But in doing so, has allowed his timing to actually match up better with his teammates coming in towards there as the two Molotovs, in fact, hold back the retake as AZ is the one who will see GMX first. Zipnix does what he does best, sits in the pit, plays it very passive until the last moment. And Kiyoshima gets himself the kill onto him. Now Kiyoshima goes in. Second frag for Kiyoshima. FXO's in there as well. And Epsilon are not going to be able to get the defuse. It was good, but it wasn't good enough. And they'll lose another man in the process.
No kit. Don't be a buy a kit.
Talk us through that retake from Epsilon. It worked.
It worked. I mean, okay. So what we saw there was Dignitas got the first kill on SF over at the B-bomb site through the smoke. SF kind of wanted to get some spam bullets through the smoke, but he didn't need to. He could have held the smoke exit angle. If Dignitas wanted to push through it, they had to push through it, and he could have held a safe angle instead. Instead, he got killed through it. So what Epsilon's reaction was, 4 versus 5, let's, instead of just trying to hold our spots 2A, 2B, let's try to equalize it. Shox went into the apartments, tried to get into the window room, maybe kill a person setting up in alt mid. Instead, that was a great setup, by the way. That was a good setup.
Here we go, we'll come back to it as Dignitas ready to make their push in towards the B site. Kiyoshima does dispatch of Dupree. Now he's gonna have to go big, gets himself the frag onto AZ, but right in his face was Fetish ready to push in. We have two Dig players left up against 3 Epsilon as FXO goes down to level us up at 2-on-2. Fetish has just half health, the 2 Epsilon players are fully armed and dangerous as the bomb ticks away. Fetish avenges with a kill onto GMX, and now it's all Shox, 1 versus 2. He is a man that can, but he's between a rock and a hard place as both Dignitas players make themselves very hard to find. And when he does, he is dispatched by Zipnix. Excellent play from Dignitas to go 7-0 up.
That's huge. So just to quickly point out that setup, Epsilon, they had 2 players playing side by side with each other, taking an off angle. You don't expect them to be at that angle. They're not in the exactly how Vendetta's pointing out. They're in that middle of the opening, but they're not on the site steps and they're not in spawn. They're kind of just in the middle. And you don't peek out, as a terrorist point of view, peeking out expecting someone to be there, let alone 2 people. They got the nice kill and they fell back with that, but that still wasn't enough to stop the Dignitas push.
Yeah, you see FXO retreating back into an exploding nade. And so Epsilon will push in and rattle off a few shots. Dignitas on that banana walkway will just retreat back in. Interestingly, yep. Epsilon in 7 rounds have never actually been able to control banana. We've never seen what, for example, Crimson Olives do for Fnatic, which is race down there. They own banana, and they do it either successfully or unsuccessfully, but they go all in on it. They've not been able to do that.
Have you been noticing if they're smoking down to the bottom of banana or not?
No, they sit very much at the top of banana, so they don't give them any opportunity to push down.
So if they want to push down, what they need to do is they have to throw a smoke from CT spawn that goes into the bottom of the banana choke point by the logs, and then that way they can cut off the terrorist basically rotation or support, I guess, from the T-stairs, from the what you want to call the underpass area. I don't think my words for it are politically correct.
Zipnix will lead the push-in. We'll come back to that argument in just a second as Fetish will be the first man to see action. It's going to be Kiyoshima who will go down to AZ, and the B push is alive and well with Dignitas now as they will move that bomb into position and he's there. But talk about the role of Zipnix now as the two-man rotation will come down to just one as Zipnix finds GMX and goes for it. Shox is a long way gone now, 1-on-3. He had a 1-on-2 last time out and exactly the same setup from Dignitas. You've got 3 people, set them up like a triangle, very far away from each other, and that will leave him and FXO downed by the Dignitas side. It is 7 now, about to be 8-0 to Dignitas. And let's continue that discussion on banana. It's not the right or the wrong thing to push down there, but there's been so little variation on that B defense.
So Epsilon, they're doing something very different than, you know, on Dust 2 we saw them, they'd push B tunnels, they'd push, you know, cat, they would take control of places, they would go aggressive for a pick with a knock. But here we're seeing them doing it just default passive. There's no variation, there's no stacks, there's no pushes, there's no like double arch, there's no double porch. They're playing a 1-1-1-1, well, 2-1-1-1 setup. One person arch, one person porch, one person apartments, one and two people B.
But, and is that maybe a reaction to a lack of confidence having lost Dust 2?
It could be a lack of confidence, but going back to the round I was talking about, you know, Epsilon, four players, Stroxy pushing to the winner room, maybe trying to get a kill at alternate middle. I mean, maybe it's that, I don't know, they're too scared. Lack of confidence, it must be. Like here, they're completely pushed back. We don't expect them to be doing that. Dignitas has full map control. They can do, we saw last round they did an A fake. They sent out two players A with smokes and flashes, and the other three of them went B, and then Zipnix had a perfect lurk flank on them. And it looks like Epsilon's letting them do this every single round.
Even Shox, who's a touch get right-ish, if you will, normally likes to roam. You really get in someone's face. He's anchored to the site. Zipnix is going to push in now, looking for that frag onto FXO. The flash does its job, and FXO gets himself the kill. Good play. FXO helps himself to another before Dupree will shut that down, and that famous power has done its job. But here is, for the third round in a row, the B push. Finally, they get themselves a bite back as Device will go down. Now SF is the next man to see action, with Dupree cutting through and getting down. Bomb planted. It's Device 1-on-3, and he's going to play this one semi-aggressively, trying to search out that frag to bring it down, but in doing so, he's just lost a lot of health. And Epsilon are going to win their first round of the half, but it's been a long time coming.
Well, no one's on the bomb.
They were looking for the kit.
but right there, we saw a great reaction from Dignitas again. They did the A fake. They had full map control. They did the A fake. FXO actually doing something different, getting a couple of kills over at the arch side. That really helped the team. Then we saw Shox forfeit arch side, and then that let Dignitas do an actual B split. Instead of attacking the A site, they faked A, they put pressure on A, they did the smokes, they did the flashes, they sent players there, but they split through spawn and sent the other couple, or was it three players through banana? And they just got those kills to get into the bomb site. It was just Epsilon's retake. It was too strong.
But now fully armed and dangerous, they haven't actually changed much. It's that position of FXO that worked again, but smokes on banana, non-existent.
Mm-hmm.
And that allows AZ and Device to just push up.
The other thing I want to point out is, if we look at the time, minute 23 is when that smoke at the banana choke point was thrown. That gives Dignitas so much time to work with. Right now, okay, that one's going to go away at 1 minute. They throw another, 40 seconds, that's gone. That's all their B smokes. Dignitas has effectively 40 seconds to do a B hit with that.
We've hit GMX. He is down. We're on it. Man up. FXO going to go looking, and Zipnik's going to sit and say, come to me. And Dignitas are ready to go. They're steamrolling this. And remember, having lost 8 in a row, winning one and then losing the next, further suicide for Epsilon. As the push will come in, it's Shox. Almost head-to-head with Dupree. He'll go in, and then Dupree will get the better of him. And, Dignitas have complete control of the A site. The two players at B know that if they die, they won't be rebuying.
Mm-hmm.
And they will try to hold on to whatever they've got. Device happy to roll the dice. We'll wait for reinforcements before making this push, and they are starting to come. And he's looking for Kiyoshima. One through CT spawn, two players here. Again, the second gun never far away. Now he's got the Zipnix there to go. The pair of them are ready to help him charge this one out. Kiyoshima's going to get down first, and Device is going to get the next one. Anyway, great round from Dignitas to close that out. And if there were any doubts, if you were ever dreaming of an Epsilon comeback, it just got that much harder.
Shattered. There's actually three things I want to point out there. One, that being Dignitas chasing down those last two players. Device spotted out where they were. They kind of isolated them. He waited for reinforcements. The reinforcements came. If he went to challenge them, they could at least get the trade kills, eliminate Epsilon's economy. The other thing I wanted to point out was Epsilon, once they were in a man disadvantage, they did the same thing, pushed a guy into halls. Zipnix was waiting there in the halls, killed, I believe it was GMX, trying to get the flank. We should go back in game because I think they're killing people at the moment. And the third thing was that the Epsilon players at the end of the round there, they played two in the B bomb site, and Shox played A by himself. They were kind of gambling. Basically, they hoped that Dignitas would go back and execute in B, and they'd have two players there. If they didn't, I mean, they weren't going to win the round if they rotated anyway. So that was their thought process behind that round. They're not going to win it. If they come A, Shoxy can do his best to try to 1v5. If they go B, they have two players there. They could actually win the round. and Dignitas ended up going A and then going back to B to get the exit kill. So, I mean, this is not going the way of Epsilon at the moment. They're on an eco round here with Deagles and I'd imagine CZs as well, but they're just getting picked off one by one. Their economy is just in the toilet.
And no matter how much you want to, you know, think, well, what if something could have gone differently? Mm-hmm. The list of things that could have gone differently is small. Dignitas have just been very, very strong.
Yep. But it's also Dignitas' patience. Like, you see them get a kill, instead of just reacting right away and just saying, oh, we got a kill here, let's go. They're just sitting and they're waiting for the Epsilon reaction. They sit in the apartments and wait for someone to push them. They wait at B, they wait at A, they just wait everywhere. Epsilon's gonna make a reaction and they're gonna get punished for making that reaction. And then from there, that's when Dignitas makes their move.
There we go, Device is gonna be the one to lead that charge up towards B. Looking for that hit onto SF every time. It's common position, but SF has given him that hit a few times as well. And he will just keep those two players isolated in there with that Molotov as well. No commitment from Dignitas. They've not been able to actually see any of the Epsilon players in this round. But that's fine for them. They're the ones with a 9-round and 1-map cushion. It'll be Device still holding him. That smoke this time later.
It is a bit later, yeah. About 25 seconds, I'll fade.
Matt still hasn't actually forced a commitment from Dig either way. The bomb is just with Fetish at the moment. And there you got the two now ready to make their push in towards A, allowing them to think that smoke may have forced a bit of a fake and will push in now with Dupree. Dupree gets an open shot on towards Shox. GMX and FXO get it, and Epsilon by the bait. Dignitas clean straight on in and will go straight towards that site. The Kiyoshima has now turned around and recovered with a headshot on towards Device. Fetish will at least be allowed to get this bomb down. We're running out of Danes, though. Fetish has AZ for company against four Frenchmen as they go in. Fetish gets the first frag after mounting that bomb, and Fetish just jumps out and smacks GMX in the face, and it'll be 2-on-2. FXO and SF left standing. FXO not even committing. He's going to hold on.
He's stuck in, he's glitched into the wall, so he can't actually do anything, which is unfortunate, but so what happens when you play that angle, I guess. You gotta take the risk with one in a million chance of getting stuck in the wall.
We're looking at the overlay map just thinking, why isn't he moving?
Yeah, I know, I'm just like, did he lag out, what's going on? No, he's just glitched in the wall.
Now obviously that changes a bit when you analyze it was in the end a 4v2 retake, yeah. But even, first of all, buying the bait.
Yeah, that was textbook double fake. They did the smokes on B, they did the mollies, they did the flashes. They sent like one person in. Or actually, I don't even think they sent anyone in. But what we saw Fetish doing there with the bomb is he started running back down Banana, back towards middle, and then started walking back to B. And then that's when the A players, they just, without smokes or flashes, they just pushed up without anything and just got the gun battle. And then both the B players from Epsilon rotated out. That's when Dignitas went straight into the site. Textbook.
And then just even the push in towards A, the fake, it was a very clean and expensive push for Epsilon because Shox was just open in the site. The crossfire wasn't there to help him. Mm-hmm. And he got downed in a clean one-on-one.
Yep.
11-1 though. Dignitas just romping away, sending a message. How much do you as a player look to the other results in the tournament and think, oh, they stomped them. I'm a little more worried about playing them. Or are you just worried about playing anyone?
You got to look at the map and you have to look at, I mean, for us, we're confident on Inferno, for example. We never played Inferno here, unfortunately. If we did, maybe I'd be playing right now instead of, you know, talking about it. If I saw that Dignitas was, you know, 12-1 up against Epsilon on this map, maybe we would think twice about, yeah, I mean, our CT side's good, but like, how good is it?
Dupree comes in, gets himself the kill onto FXO. That Molotov doing a job onto GMX on the other side, and it's now Shox who's being held out of the bomb site. And Dignitas are bomb planted, five man after plant. Just cleaning up. There's just so little resistance here.
Oh.
Yoshima. Stuck.
That is unlucky.
And down by AZ. It's just phenomenal play from Dignitas. It'll be Fnatic that they would go on to meet. And Fnatic will be watching this and thinking, maybe we don't want to, maybe Inferno is a map we want to get rid of.
All right, so Fnatic's getting rid of Nuke, Inferno, Dust 2. How many maps are left?
They may be more than happy to be playing Cobblestone and Overpass.
Fair play. They can get one or the other. They've played both this tournament in the group stage.
To be fair, on Inferno against Navi, it wasn't an easy round for them.
Wasn't pretty. Same thing with Nuke, though.
Device gets himself the kill onto Epsilon, and it will be Device coming back, dropping Kiyoshima. The competition in this one for Epsilon is gone. The fight, the will, the hunger. They're just being rolled by Dignitas. They're making a quarterfinalist look very average.
When you're down this severe in the first half, your confidence just gets shot.
Stop talking to each other.
You start like just tunneling in. You get this feeling like we're about to lose. It's just a matter of time. And once that gets in your head, it's just over from there. I mean, Shox, I don't think Shox would ever get that feeling. I think Shox is going to fight all the way to the end. But you can see it in the faces, the expressions. Oh. Like, this guy's got his...
Fetch tried the knife. And Shox wasn't going to have it. But will go down anyway. As Dipnix gets himself the kill. Now, how much, as well, on top of, you know, the lack of confidence, does the online element of this anger you? Does the fact that, you know, there are 150,000, 200,000 people watching this, they're going to be the comments lying in wait, waiting for you online. Does that play into it? Do you just start thinking about how good this might look or bad to other people?
For some players, definitely.
Not you, of course, with your aggression.
Honestly, yeah, for me, it's completely different. As everyone knows, I'm arrogant, I'm cocky, I'm always, ooh, what's going on here? We saw a B push from Epsilon.
They did, they pushed straight out and it's paid dividends with three frags for them. Fetish has been the one in the end who gets there. Shox down to 5 points of health against two. Fetish and Zipnix, as they will, well, the bomb and Shox is going to come right onto the end of Fetish here, who will, with that Molotov, oh, it was taken off his toes in the end by Zipnix. GMX one to go, they double nated that area and GMX is going to walk straight through the smoke and get dropped by Zipnix, but they rolled the dice and they almost came out stronger. It is 14-1 at halftime. And ladies and gentlemen in the crowd, make some noise. Look at the Kappa face in the background as we are moving on to a second half that is, well.
Do or die.
Do you believe in the Easter Bunny?
No.
Do you believe in Father Christmas?
I'm glad I'm getting these questions, not the other ones you were talking about pre-cast.
Just don't, wondering if you believe don't. In a miracle.
Is the sky blue?
It is.
Well, I don't.
Actually, it's pretty
is the
great
sky
today.
Red?
Yeah. To the online point. Obviously,
online point.
With your you know, Twitter debate with Lurpus earlier, we know you're not worried about what might be written about you. But to another player, to a younger player, what effect can it have?
To a newer player, to someone who's not experienced on the stage, or to someone who other people's opinions really affect them, it can take a toll. Like, you're just sitting there thinking like, oh, I just messed up this round. Even if it's one round, one frag, one play, like, you could be like, oh, someone's gonna make a thread about Steele screwed up this round and he cost the team the map. And it's like, I don't think about that. I'm just thinking about, how can I rectify this? How can I... okay, I made this mistake. Let's not make it again. And then fix it. I know for the next time, I'm not going to, you know, screw up that same way. And I think for some players, they just get down on themselves. They just think about it and keep thinking about it. We can see... I'm not entirely sure who that is, but
we can see manic depression on the stage.
Is that manic? Oh, that's... Sorry, maniac. But maniac's not on this team. Manic depression. That is a severe form of... lack of confidence right there.
In the contrasting side where Device is giving the thumbs up to the camera,
yeah.
You scroll across and you see just weeping.
Yeah, and then we see Fetish, he's cracking a smile with his mean face.
Yeah, it's not a smile, it's a win this or I will kill you. Anyway, Dignitas two rounds away from victory here, and a 2-0 as Epsilon would be eliminated from the tournament. You heard it here. Steel doesn't believe. But as Caster, I don't believe you can sing. But as a Caster, our job is to believe.
No, your job is to hype. My job is to provide analysis.
Oh, you're so brutal. As here we are on the pistol round. If Epsilon are to begin a fairy tale comeback, it must start right here. Or otherwise it will end right here. And we have Epsilon pushed a couple players up in towards A, and now GMX getting himself the kill on towards Fetish will now force Zipnix to find action in the shape of GMX once again, and Epsilon have opened up the B-bomb site with two frags from GMX, and whoa, what a hit from afar from Device, who himself has just 6 points of health, and now a bomb to defuse with four Epsilon players to take care of, and only two Dig players left alive.
And the Dignitas players are actually choosing to save for two reasons. One, Izzy's got a Molotov, or an incendiary grenade, and Dupree's got armor. So two huge crucial points right here. Dupree, he's basically got his equipment for the next round. AZ, all he has to do is get armor, maybe a CZ, and he's good to go. The other thing is, Dignitas, they had two players, one with like 6 HP, one with 4 HP. They were really low at the start of the round, and Epsilon, that was their round to get. They were doing so much damage, they were getting into the entry points, they pushed Dignitas far back. That's exactly what they need to get back into this game, but they need to keep their heads up. They need to make sure that on these next rounds here, they don't lose a single player. If they lose players and they lose their economy, that's just gonna kill them in the end. It's just such an endurance race at this point. They need to maximize their economy. That's the most important thing they can do.
The start of a beautiful comeback was that.
Yep.
Yes, it was. You heard it here first from Steel. He's changed his opinion up to just one round.
Well, it's a start. It's a start. There are optimists in the world and there are pessimists. Guess which I am.
You're Canadian.
Ooh.
You are an optimist. He shocks to jump up. He's got two players to find, and he alerts them to his presence, and they just sat, and Shox is going to get them both. As Epsilon will now make a push in towards the site where Device is lying in wait, gets the headshot, and he will now have to go for four more because he's going to get the second. It's SF that goes down. Now Device, point blank range shoot, almost would have favored him there, but it's Fetish that comes through. And what did he say about not allowing kills?
Mm-hmm.
As bomb is planted, but there are still two angry Danes to be dispatched of, and they do exactly that.
And I'm gonna go ahead and say it. Great round by Dignitas. They didn't win it, but they got two kills. What does this do? Epsilon, those two players that die, they can buy armor, their teammates drop them weapons. We look at their economy though. They don't have economy. They have two players that have money, really, and then three players that don't really have any money. If they lose this round, I mean, they could have, you know, a couple of AKs, but the rest of them, they've got nothing. So if Dignitas is able to keep chipping away at the economy, they're going to end up winning in the end of the game because Epsilon's not going to have money for grenades. They're not going to have good money for AKs. They're just going to be Galil armor, or they're going to be pistol with grenades and armor. And that's a disadvantage. You can't keep playing that way. So right here, Epsilon only losing one player. That's a good round.
Dignitas rushed out. Got swatted away by the Epsilon sign, and now it will be a gun round. And remember, for Epsilon, they are in a situation where they must win everything from here on in, or they are going home in the quarterfinals. $100,000 for first place.
You don't have to remind me. That is a low blow.
I was just stating the facts. Zipnix is ready to go. He will retreat back to join Fetish in that site. He's taken a huge chunk of health, though, Zipnix. He's down to 51 points of health. He did do some damage to FXO, but into B they'll go, and the Dignitas A rotation hasn't even started as SF gets himself that first frag onto Zipnix, finishes off the job. GMX comes in with the second, and those three players at A, they were late in the movement, and in the end they decided they're too late in the movement.
Yep, that was a great take by Epsilon there. I mean, Zipnix was in a good position to get an opening kill. We saw Fetish actually flashing, as well as Zipnix flashing, to kind of bail him out of that situation. But at the end of that, Epsilon's smokes were in great positions. One of the players was able to get down to that broken wall area, or that the half wall, I guess. At this point, though, Epsilon, they shouldn't be chasing for these frags. They don't need them. They need to build their economy. Every death that they get is going to be bad for them. This is really bad. This is going to be costing them in the end. It doesn't matter about Dig's economy right now. It matters about their own. They don't have the rounds to play around with.
There will be one more to Dig as AZ gets it. It is 14-5. Walk us through, if you're the first time who's looked at a game at Counter-Strike, talk us through the economy that you're explaining.
Okay, so the economy is that every round win that you get, depending on if it's a... you win because the bomb blew up, or you win because you eliminated all the enemies, you get between 3250 and 3500 for the round win. But every time you die, you have to buy the weapons. It costs 2700 bucks for an AK, armor is another $1,000. So right there, if you want to get a buy round, you want around $4,000 to $5,000 per terrorist on a buy round. If you lose a round, you only get $1,400 on that first round loss, $1,900 and plus $500 each time. We're going to see it actually be pushed here from Epsilon straight into Dignitas. And Dignitas is...
Oh, Fetish! You would have put them finishing that off. But no, the knife wasn't to be. But look at the damage that they've done. Epsilon, 7, 28, and 20. It's not going to be easy 3-on-5, but they've brought them down to bite-sized pieces. And AZ and Dupree aren't that hungry. It will be... Shox going out, getting himself the headshot on towards Dupree. And, now we'll hunt down AZ, who's hard to find. Go back to your explanation.
Yeah, so you get plus 500 for each consecutive round loss. But for Epsilon, they're only getting $3,000 each time they win a round. $3,000 doesn't give them the $4,000 to $5,000 that they need to kind of replenish what they've lost. So each time they lose a player, they're kind of losing money. So in this situation, hunting down Dignitas players, is it necessary? They just did an eco round. They saved those two weapons. Dignitas, I think they could buy at this point. So to lose more Epsilon players on that, it doesn't necessarily make sense. Let's say Epsilon wins in, they only have one player alive at the end of the round for the next 4 or 5 rounds. They're going to be at such a low buy. It's still going to be 14 to 11 for Dignitas. And Epsilon, they're going to be just running low in money. They need to maximize their economy.
14-16. Epsilon have won 5 straight rounds in the second half. Sipnix takes a peek and says the Frenchmen are coming again on B. But they haven't followed up, and still the 3 on A haven't bought. One now does as the nades come in. And Epsilon, heavy bait, if you will, moves slowly back. Fetish is going to get himself the frag onto Kirishima, who was left behind. The 4 players still sat there. No commitment. So the man on A has gone back. You can see one player now just taking a look at middle to see whether anyone's coming from behind and to see whether the road is clear. So Fetish pushes out, loses out to GMX, and now they're forced to go in, Epsilon, as they make the push. Zipnix is there, 40 seconds left on the clock. Zipnix gone. Device comes in with the frag onto SF. He's the man who moved over from A early, as now reinforcements are coming. Or are they? It's Shox, who's coming right from behind. He will sound the alarm that he's there, and FXO will show nothing, and then Shox will finish off the job on him, as Dupree is now the one to come through CT's board, looking for that frag. As he gets one into the side, it's GMX that goes down, but Shox still looking for the frag. Epsilon with 2 players on low health, Dignitas with 2 players on full health, but the bomb ticking louder and louder, as this could be Epsilon's swan song, as Shox finishes off AZ. One-on-one, Shox versus Dupree, who's got little to no time, and Shox will come around that corner. The bomb will blow anyway, but Shox is going to finish off the 5 frags, and that's a round for Epsilon. The deficit is now just 7, and the Easter Bunny is looking more and more real.
It is looking real at this point. And actually, Epsilon has quite a lot of money in the bank still. Even though they lost all 5 of their players there, they were able to replenish their money. It's going to be a difficult battle for Dignitas, but at this point, because they just keep losing these rounds, and they keep force buying. It looks like they have Faumuses. They're not doing like full buys at the moment. They're opting for nades, but they're sacrificing their weapons. Maybe they should just at this point, Epsilon has the economy. Maybe Dignitas should do a full save, get an op, switch things up, maybe get an opening pick somewhere with an op. Maybe do we see them doing the passive setups all the time. Maybe instead they try an aggressive, one of those risky plays like I was mentioning earlier, how they never do, and maybe they should opt to do a riskier play in a higher tension match when they can just throw off the enemy. Even if it's just for one round, they get that one round, they're on match point, they broke Epsilon's money, Epsilon's back to, you know, 1400 bucks.
At what point do you start to feel the pressure of losing six rounds in a row and you have that cushion dropping down to, I'm not going to even say it's just because it's still a huge cushion,
yeah,
but dropping to seven rounds?
I mean, it gets in your head a little bit, but you just look at the score at the end and you just say, listen, it's 14-7 still. We have seven rounds to still close this out. Eight.
Molotov forces back one. Dupree gets himself the kill onto GMX, and this is looking much better for Dignitas. Three quick kills, and reports of Dignitas' demise have been greatly exaggerated as Shox is left one on three. He will focus on the objective, but will be hunted down by the Danes. What can he do to save himself? Not much. That smoke couldn't come out quick enough to give him any form of a diversion, and we will move to some eight match points.
Yep, and they were quick thrills as well, actually. Not just kills, they were thrills. We didn't see, but they were.
You were a poet and you didn't know it.
Yep. Ooh, that rhymed too. Got Eminem Jr. in the making.
I taught Eminem everything he knows. I am the most gangster man in an esport.
God.
Or not. Eight rounds to close this one out for Dignitas. What did they do right on that last one?
They locked down their sights. Epsilon kind of just ran into them. Didn't. I think Epsilon was one of the previous rounds going B?
Yeah.
That round they attacked A, and I think the Vice started off with a couple of crucial kills.
It's Fetish who's caught behind the car and with nowhere to go. GMX eventually finished him off. Epsilon have lost Shox, the big star. So it'll be pushing in, coming in from GMX. He gets himself a frag and a Zipnix in the back. Wasn't necessarily expecting Device to be around there so quickly, and was just walking in with his pants down. FXO now will charge Device and will down Device as Epsilon look to get that bomb planted. And they have a retake coming in from AZ and Dupree. Bomb has been planted, and the frag has come onto Dupree. It's AZ last man up, and they will win this round. It will be 15-8. A good recovery, and again, it was B that held the reward for Epsilon.
Epsilon's definitely liking this B take, and it's working for them. What Dig tried there is an aggressive B control, try to control Banana by the car. What they had done is they had actually moved Device early into the B bomb site. Once the two players, that's Fetish and Zipnix, died over at B, Epsilon's like, oh, site must be clear. They started running in, they paid no attention to Device in the site, and Device could have actually picked up a couple more kills than he did, but I mean, it's hard in that situation to kind of, you know, multi-frag. You're kind of trapped at a box, and you're going to get it overrun.
The cushion down to seven once again. Does Epsilon get a morale-boosting round victory? This half, they've lost just one round. Their T side has been fantastic, which, against the Dignitas side that are also so famed for CT play, not so much.
Yeah, and this is the round, this is what they need to do. Dignitas taking a risk, buying the op on Fetish, the rest of them are on pistols, getting an op, kind of moving him around. As soon as he got that kill, he's gone. He's somewhere else now. And this is exactly what they need to do to kind of throw Epsilon off guard. They needed to start taking these risks. They have match point. That's all they need to do. Boom, 5-on-3 right now. This is looking huge.
In the words of Cadian, boom,
boom,
as it will be the second frag coming in from Fetish as he moved up towards that B site. But Fetish now down. There are just three Epsilon players left up. One of them does have the Orbit's GMX, and Zipnix will go through. Man advantage, yes, for Dignitas, but Shox is going to be the man who should be able to create an opening for Epsilon in towards that B site. Inches closer towards Zipnik, spies him, tags him, puts him down, 65 points of health. Can he finish off the job? He's going to make it hard for him, but he's going to get the kill. And now Epsilon take the invitation to go in towards the site. Losing GMX in the process, we're in a 2 versus 2, and one of them on just 11 points of health. But look at the weapons on that Dignitas side. Not much to work with for AZ. As, he can see the AWP, he wants the AWP. But, the Molotov is there to make that hard. Dupree gets himself the frag onto SF, and now it is all on Shox to hold onto this round. Gets the first frag. AZ comes in with the AWP and downs him, and that's going to be Dignitas, surely, to finish off the game. Dignitas have defeated Epsilon, and it will be a clean sweep for the Dignitas side as they do in the end. Get that defuse.
I wasn't sure. I didn't know how much time was left on the bomb. I was just like, but I was still like in awe. Like, Dig just won that round. Like, whoa, that was huge.
Like, whoa, never has it been put so sweetly. We're gonna throw it over to the analysis desk. Steel, thank you so much for your time. We'll be back with you later, but over to you, Scoots.
All right, thank you very much, guys. Thank you, Steel, thank you, Tossbot. So, wow. Again, no easy way to say horrible first side by Epsilon. But again, for a few brief moments, the comeback was real. We both tried anti-jinxing. I wrote Dignitas in my bracket ahead of time to help you. But then you tweeted the comeback was real and you anti-jinxed the jinx.
Yeah, so basically I am the turning point of the game and I make Dignitas come back. No, that was an excellent play from Dignitas in the first half, just completely flawless. The first five rounds passed in, I don't know, 5 minutes. It was just how quick it was and how easy it looked for Dignitas right now. I mean, they're extremely confident and you can just see that in their game. So very, very good game from them.
I mean, for me, it was about them just taking their foot off the pedal, really, there in the second half. Dignitas, you're 14-1 up at halftime. You've absolutely battered your opponents. I mean, that is a masterclass on how to play T-sided Inferno. But not only that, I thought Epsilon were really poor and exposed consistently throughout. Second half, for 2016-8, I think that really flatters Epsilon, to be honest. I think Dignitas just took the foot off the accelerator and just let the rounds come in. I mean, Epsilon just went B-site every round.
Yeah, I mean, once you're up 14-1 and you just have still 2 best of 3s to be played on the bracket, on the second side, you're just going to try to play classic and, you know, you're not going to give your best strategies to win a round because you know that somehow by an individual play, you're just going to take 1 or 2 rounds and that's all they needed to close the game. So, excellent plays, a lot of confidence and a very great game from them.
I got to say as well, Nathan, I don't know what you make of this. We talked a lot about star players and what Shox was going to do for his team today. He didn't turn up. Not the Shox I know, anyway.
Well, I think it's the like his leader, his new role in the team, you know. Now he has to take up the whole team, being sure everyone is on the same page, making the tactics, having everything ready for the team. So it's going to be harder for him to be that star player. Like, if things start running on, then he's going to be, you know, feeling extremely confident. All his goals are going to be good and all his plays as well. So that's probably the problem with Epsilon right now. If they start off pretty wrong, then it's going to be tough to come back from them.
And we've got the stats up as well. And once again, it was the double D team, Device and Dupree. Yep. What I noticed, Nathan, in especially in the first half, as terrorists, Device was getting the first pick so many times and just making Dignitas play 5v4.
But I think it was just Epsilon not being confident into their setups because as if Dignitas goes into a bomb site and I get picks left and right, and like it looked that easy, unfortunately, for Epsilon. And they looked surprised every time they got killed or every time someone was in front of him. And I think that was probably the turning point of the game, like where you can see it was not going to work for Epsilon. So Dignitas, you know, Device and Dupree, as you said, playing extremely well, getting all the needed kills. And then, although there has been a lot of 3-on-3 situations that happened on Dust 2 as well, they kept losing them. Like Epsilon kept losing those rounds where they were 4-3 or 3-3, and that was also why the score is so brutal. And that's also where you can see like Dignitas is playing at the top of their level.
You said something very profound when we were talking off camera, and you said that Dignitas are so strong, you just didn't know what was making them strong.
Right. Yeah, well, when a team is that confident in playing that well, anything they're going to do is going to work, because the players are going to have this mentality that I am the best, so if I go on a bump site, I'm going to kill everyone, no matter if they're 4 or 5, I'm just going to be the one destroying them.
Yeah.
And that's when a team dominates another team or a whole year. And IPL are in the same, we're in the same exact scenario at the beginning of the game of CSGO. They dominated for 1 year, not because they had the best tactics, but because they started off very strong and then they got confidence event after event. And they went up 87-0-9, which is a crazy result. And Dignitas now on that game, and even since the beginning of the tournament, they look extremely solid and very strong. So they can definitely make it to the final and win the whole event if they keep this momentum and this confidence into the game.
And speaking of that, you know, let's kind of move on. There's not really a whole lot to break down on that second map, unfortunately. But obviously now we've got Fnatic Dignitas in that upper bracket. Thoughts on that?
Oh, very
you specifically, because we'll obviously talk about it a lot.
Yeah, we
want to get your stuff on this.
For me, it's going to be a very scary game because those two teams are working with confidence. We practiced Fnatic a lot of times, way more than Dignitas. And we always knew that Dignitas are relying on confidence in the way they were playing. They're just going into a bomb site, like just running straight and like getting the kills. And that's what makes their strength when they're in their game. Fnatic are kind of the same thing, especially in the form of Creams and Olofmeister. Those two additions are working that way. Sometimes they're just going to go crazy in the mind, like rush one spot, kill everyone, and boom, that's going to be the round for Fnatic. So that's where it's going to be a very, very explosive game between Fnatic and Dignitas. And I think the Danish guys have got a small upper side, a small upper advantage, because they come in winning 2-0 straight. Not going to say smashing the group stage because they obviously lost against Cloud9, but very solid games overall, and I would say 60-40 for Dignitas.
All right, and one more question for you before we send you away. Again, obviously, thanks for having you today. But the next match that we will do today is LDLC.com versus VODS Pro. 4 out of 5 from LDLC, obviously, are your fellow Frenchmen. Quick prediction, quick thought on that matchup.
He's already said something outrageous. Wait till you hear it.
No, I think VODS Pro are on a roll since month. They are, like, thinking about it, they are, like, not going to say the Golden 5, but they're the new Golden 5 pretty much, because Snax and Bayati are an extremely good addition to the team, and they proved it already. LDLC, they're coming into this tournament brand new. They were completely under the radar before this tournament. They have brand new tactics, brand new things into the game, and I think they can show off pretty strong. But VODS Pro, they were probably the toughest game, like the toughest quarterfinal they could have gotten out of all of the teams. So once again, for me, it's going to be a crazy game. I really hope it's going to go to 3 maps and, well, I'm obviously rooting for the Frenchies. That's something that is pretty obvious, you know, but I think it can really go either way because both teams practice the new maps. Both teams are very strong. They've got new things. They've got excellent players, very sneaky players in the form of Maniac for LDLC and Snax for VODS Pro. I just can't wait to see that game.
All right. Well, thank you very much. Appreciate it. Love watching you play, but also love chit-chatting with you about Counter-Strike. That being said, we're going to send it right to Red Eye at the stage. Take it away, Paul.
Thanks very much, Scott. Yes, with Fenish from Team Dignitas. First of all, congratulations on the win. Another semi-final. You seem to be getting better and better in terms of getting to semi-finals last fours, but I have to ask you the obvious question. It's quite a harsh one. When are you going to get to the final?
Now? I don't know. There's a lot of great teams here, so...
I mean, what is it about you guys? Because we know how good you are. We know how good an in-game leader you are. We know the strategies that you employ can confuse teams and destroy teams. We saw it in the second map. And yet, somehow, I don't want to say to use the word choke, but you seem to get to semi-finals. It looks great. You've beaten some great teams. You beat NiP at Gfinity, for instance. And it doesn't work. Why?
Well, at Gfinity, we faced VODS Pro, and they went on to win the event. So we should have been in the final, but we would probably still have lost to them. There's no shame in losing, and we only prepared like 5 or 6 days prior to that event. So I don't really think about it like that. We have some mental state issues in our team, like coming from being down, and like at this event, we lost both pistols, or we lost both ecos, but won both pistols against Cloud9, but we still kind of came back, and that's the things that we need to work on. It's more about the mental thing than it is anything else. It's not strategies, and it's nothing about that.
Okay, let's talk about the match, because it was a terrific match. CT side on Dust 2, talk me through it. What were you thinking? What were the strategies? What kind of execution did you put in place?
Well, when we played CT, we pretty much knew how they were going to play it. And they played accordingly to how we talked about them playing. But we had some startup problems. We won the pistol, then we obviously lost to a CZ eco. That's normal by now. But we knew how they were going to play it, and then the guys just played amazing. So it was pretty easy.
And then second map, we move on to Inferno. We all know it's a fairly balanced map, but most people think that you get a few more rounds on CT, basically, and you basically destroyed the meta for us. It's 14-1. Is it harder when you switch over, when you're leading 14-1 like that, on the verge of, you know, two map points, to get it done than it is when maybe it's 9-6?
Like, you get a bit unconcentrated, like, you get a bit unfocused, and then you start making silly mistakes. But that map was really just us proving to all those commentators calling us only a CT team, because it's a bit annoying, because it's like none of them watch Gfinity. Because we are amazing on T-sides. Obviously, some maps are just really, really CT-sided, so to getting 2, 3, 4 rounds is just, that's great, that's good enough. But our T-side, and that's why we picked Inferno, because we knew they were going to pick an open map that is like, that's what you want to do at this. You want to pick an open map so you force the opponent team to get on the weaker side on the second map. But we knew our T side on Inferno was really strong, so we didn't fear them. And starting CT on Dust 2 is just, it's good for us.
I don't want to demean any of the Epsilon players, but there's one man that stands out. Shox is obviously he's a monster. Do you take that into account when you put those strategies together? I know how detailed they are, but do you concentrate on one man and think, if we can close him down, it makes things easier?
No, that would be like saying, like, there's a lot of hype or a lot of talks about Fifflan not being good enough and all that shenanigans. But for us, you don't go to a site where he is, or that's not how it works. We work as a team, and we focus on the other team as being a team, because they are going to do setups as well, and we need to counter the setups, not the guys who are in the setup. So that's how we do it.
Well, congratulations, well done. You are through to the semi-finals once again. Best of luck in that one. One final question. It's Fnatic, previous winners. It's going to be a tough match all round. I mean, I know you're not going to share any strategies with me, but mentally, what are you guys going to do to prepare for it?
I don't know. Not much. Just watch the other games and have fun and then play them.
All right. Sounds like a good strategy to me. Thank you very much, Fetish. Dignitas safely through to the semi-finals yet again at a major. Can they make it one better? We'll find out tomorrow when they return against Fnatic. Next up, another quarter-final here at ESL One Cologne. We'll see you in a few.